all about Revlimid or lenalidomide.
Lenalidomide is an oral agent. It's an oral drug that is sold in the U.S. under the trade name Revlimid. It was actually FDA approved for the first time in 2006. Now it is used as a part of a regimen for newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patient as frontline therapy in both transplant eligible as well as transplant ineligible patients. When it is used as a frontline therapy, it is combined with bortezomib and dexamethasone in transplant eligible patients, while in patients who are not transplant ineligible, if they are fragile and have comorbidities, which means other medical conditions, then it can be used alone with dexamethasone. While in patients who can tolerate three-drug regimen, it is used in combination with bortezomib and dexamethasone, as well as in combination with daratumumab and dexamethasone, again, in transplant-ineligible patients. Lenalidomide is also used as maintenance therapy after autologous stem cell transplant.
According to the NCCN, National Comprehensive Cancer Center guidelines, published on October 19, 2020, Revlimid may also be used in newly diagnosed multiple myeloma in the following combinations.
In patients who are not lenalidomide refractory or patients who tolerate lenalidomide well as a part of frontline therapy, it can be used again in relapsed and refractory setting. In those situations, in these patients, it is combined with proteasome inhibitors like carfilzomib or ixazomib or immunotherapy drugs like daratumumab or elotuzumab.
How is Revlimid administered?
Lenalidomide is taken orally. When it is used as a part of combination regimens, it is used at a dose of 25 milligrams every day, days 1 through 21 of a 28-day cycle, which means you take it every day for 3 weeks, then you have a week break.
It is important to take Revlimid at about the same time each day. Swallow the capsule whole. Do not open, break apart, or chew your capsules. Revlimid may be taken with or without food. If you miss a dose, take it as soon as you remember it if it has been less than 12 hours since your regular scheduled time. If it has been more than 12 hours, then skip the missed dose. Never take two doses at the same time. If you take too much Revlimid, call your doctor right away.
IMiDs, lenalidomide or pomalidomide can make you feel fatigued and tired. So I always tell my patients, take it at night before you go to bed. If you are taking steroids with IMiD, you can take steroids during the daytime, early morning, because steroids can interfere with sleep.
What are the common dosages and side effects of Revlimid?
When lenalidomide is used as a part of maintenance therapy after autologous stem cell transplant, it is taken as 10 milligrams every day. We have to be careful using this drug in elderly patients and fragile patients. In these patients, I start with a modified dose. I start with a lower dose, which is 15 milligrams, just to make sure that they don't get into trouble with side effects and toxicities of this drug. We have to be careful while prescribing this medication to patients who have kidney problems. In these patients, I start at a lower dose because these patients tend to get into trouble with more cytopenias like neutropenia. So I start with anywhere between 5 milligrams to 15 milligrams. And if the patient tolerates okay, then always consider going up to the maximum dose of 25 milligrams orally. In terms of side effects, the most common side effect that patients have trouble with is feeling fatigued and tired. Another side effect that bothers them is diarrhea. Patients can have myalgias, joint pains, generalized body aches and pains. Patients can have pruritus or rash as well. Lenalidomide also causes bone marrow suppression, which means it can lower the blood cell count and can cause anemia, low platelet count, and low white cell count.
Additionally, some other commonly reported side effects include swelling in the ankles and feet, muscle cramps, upset stomach, insomnia, decreased appetite, dizziness, constipation, nausea, and fever.
Some other rare side effects but adverse events that can happen are incidence of clots. We have seen patients who get lenalidomide, especially in combination, have higher incidence of getting arterial as well as venous blood clots. And there is also an increased incidence of having other malignancies.
It is important to know that Revlimid can cause fetal harm when administered to a pregnant woman, and is contraindicated in pregnant females or females capable of becoming pregnant. To avoid embryo-fetal exposure, Revlimid is only available under a restricted distribution program called Revlimid Risk Evaluation and Mitigation Strategy, or Revlimid REMS program. There are special requirements for men and women in the program. Only prescribers and pharmacies certified by the Revlimid REMS program can prescribe and dispense Revlimid to patients who are enrolled and meet all the conditions of the Revlimid REMS program. The goals of the Revlimid Risk Evaluation and Mitigation Strategy are as follows. To prevent the risk of embryo-fetal exposure to Revlimid. To inform prescribers, patients, and pharmacists on the serious risks and safe use conditions for Revlimid. You can take your mandatory confidential patient survey at CelgeneRiskManagement.com in English or Spanish. You can also complete your survey by using the Celgene REMS mobile app. For more information, visit this website. How are side effects managed?
So I always tell my patients, report each and every symptom, even if you are thinking that it's not related to drug, but always report. Make a diary, report these symptoms to your doctor. Quality of life is important, and we want patients to be able to do every day what they like to do and avoid treatment discontinuations and interruptions. But at the same time, maintain quality of life. In terms of major side effects like fatigue, if the patient is having what we call grade 3 or grade 4 fatigue, which means that they are at a point where they are not able to do what they like to do every day and are spending more time in couch and bed, then dose modification is indicated. And we slightly go down on the dose and it helps the patient and they're able to continue with the therapy. Diarrhea is another bothersome side effect that can, of course, affect the quality of your life. I always tell patients, make sure that you hydrate yourself well. Patients can use over-the-counter anti-diarrheal agents like Imodium. And there is a hypothesis that lenalidomide interferes with the absorption of bile acids in the intestine. Bile acids are the secretions from liver that go into the intestine and they help in the absorption of lipids. So lenalidomide affects the reabsorption of those bile acids and this leads to diarrhea. So in my patients, I have success in controlling the diarrhea by giving them bile acid sequestrants like cholestyramine. So that's another drug that your doctor can prescribe. And again, if the diarrhea is severe, then dose modification is indicated at that point.
Additionally, suggestions for managing diarrhea and other side effects discussed in this video can be found in the Patient Solutions tool found in HealthTree Care Hub. Search on a specific side effect to find solutions others have found helpful. These solutions have been provided by patients just like you. You can also filter side effects by an individual drug or combination of drugs. When filtering on a combination of drugs, keep in mind it may not always be clear which drug is creating which side effect.
Patients can have a rash and pruritus. This can be treated with over-the-counter antihistamine drugs like Benadryl or Cetirizine. If the rash is severe and it's generalized all over your body, then we have to treatment discontinuation for a short period of time and treat the patients with steroids. I never had to stop the treatment because of rash because we are able to control it with these agents and eventually patient becomes tolerant and do not get rash again. It can lower your cell count by causing the bone marrow suppression. So the patients get frequent blood count monitoring. And if needed, especially in patients who have relapsed refractory disease, they get blood transfusions and growth factors. We have to monitor our patients closely for infections. The infections are monitored and if needed, we do some prophylactic measures. For example, in patients who are on frontline therapy and fragile, antibiotic prophylaxis for first few months of treatment is indicated to decrease the risk of infection. In patients who are developing severe infections, needing hospitalizations, we do intravenous immunoglobulins, which is a blood product composed of antibodies. And this product helps decrease the risk of infections in myeloma patients. And always get immunizations, vaccinations. Patients should get yearly flu shot, and before they start the treatment with the anti-myeloma therapy, we always give them pneumonia vaccination. There is a risk of blood clots, arterial as well as venous. So always talk to your doctor about prophylaxis, which is medications to prevent the blood clot. We always do aspirin, which is an antiplatelet agent. In patients who are at high risk of having a blood clot, for example, the patients who have significant cardiac history, patients who have history of stroke or blood clots in past, we do prophylaxis with anticoagulation agents like Lovenox or Eliquis or other oral anticoagulants. One of the most common common side effects of IMiDs is rash and itching. So this is a side effect that can scare the patients. Rash appears as reddish spots. It can start from your body or it can start on your arms or legs, and it can spread. There can be itching associated with rash. Sometimes patients have a rash as bad as full skin involvement. It has something to do with the immunomodulating action of IMiDs. In my patients, I never give up on IMiDs because of rash. If the patient has mild rash, which means that you have some spots on your arms and your body, then I add antihistamine drugs like cetirizine during the daytime or Benadryl at night and able to control the rash. If the rash is severe, which means that it involves most of your body and is itching a lot, then I hold IMiD a drug for a week or so until the rash improves, and add cetirizine or Benadryl at night, as well as steroids like short course of prednisone. Once the rash improves, I re-challenge with the same drug. I re-challenge with lenalidomide or pomalidomide and tell the patient that when you restart your IMiD molecule drug, add cetirizine or Benadryl with it and take it together for a few weeks and then see what happens. Some patients develop rash again, and I go through the same cycle again. But eventually, patients develop tolerance and are able to take the drug without rash. There is a risk of developing other malignancies, so patients should always get their age-appropriate cancer screening, and their blood work is monitored periodically while they're on lenalidomide for any other hematological malignancy.
What are the most common second primary malignancies associated with Revlimid?
Other second malignancies include hematological malignancies. There is increased risk of developing leukemias and MDS, as well as solid tumors like colon cancer and breast cancer. I have patients in my clinic who got all of these. The percentage is small, but this is still something that we need to look for and be careful about. If you are susceptible to having skin cancer because of ethnicity or a family history or your geographical location, lenalidomide can increase that risk as well. So you need to have your skin checked as well. Prolonged use of lenalidomide can impact the ability to collect the stem cells. So if the patients decide not to get the upfront or early autologous stem cell transplant, then always discuss with the doctor about the collection and harvesting the stem cells and keeping them for future use.
What is the mechanism of action?
So lenalidomide is what we call an IMiD molecule, immunomodulating agent. This pretty much defines the mechanism of action of this drug. So this medication has a direct effect on myeloma cells and causes cell death. The target of lenalidomide is a receptor protein which is called Cereblon. Lenalidomide binds to the Cereblon and increases its affinity for certain transcription factors. And when Cereblon binds to those transcription factors, it leads to degradation of those transcription factors and eventually interrupts the pathways that are needed for cell survival, eventually leading to cell death. So lenalidomide has this effect, direct effect on myeloma cells and causes cell death. It also modulates the immune system, which means that it enhances the ability of immune system to recognize the malignant cells and activates the immune system as well. Lenalidomide does so by causing the activation and proliferation of T cells and NK cells, which are immune cells, as well as causing the inhibition of some pro-inflammatory cytokines, which are the substances in the body that cause inflammation. Lenalidomide also have anti-angiogenesis effect, which means that it decreases the blood supply to the tumor cells by decreasing certain substances like VEGF, TNF-alpha, and interleukin-6. As a result of this effect, you can say that the tumor is starved. So this is the mechanism of action of this drug, which is IMiD or lenalidomide.
What is Cereblon?
Cereblon is a receptor protein ligase. It is expressed in immune cells like B cells and T cells. It binds with the certain transcription factors and keeps them under check. When lenalidomide binds to Cereblon, it increases its affinity, its ability to bind to those transcription factors, and Cereblon is a ligase protein. It causes a degradation of those transcription factor. Lenalidomide potentiates that effect. And eventually, it interferes with a cell cycle, which is needed for cell survival and cell growth, and eventually leading to what we call apoptosis, or cell death. Myeloma cells do express cereblon. The degree of expression does vary, but they do express cereblon.
How do you know if your myeloma cells have cereblon on their surface?
If we know a molecular target for a drug, can we develop a test to quantify that target and use that test as a predictive biomarker to know if that drug is going to work or if the patient is going to be resistant to that drug? So it's a great question. So there are two parts of answer. Part number one is there is no validated test for now that can measure the protein expression of cereblon or the gene expression. Various studies have been published over the last few years that has looked at this, again, protein expression as well as gene expression. But the results of these studies are very inconsistent. A part of it, the part of the reason is that there are various gene variations in gene expression that also limits the ability of this assay. So there is no validated test right now. The second part of the answer is Revlimid or lenalidomide, again, causes this immune modulating effect. It is combined with some other anti-myeloma therapies and it has synergistic activity. Using the cereblon assay might not be consistent, might not give us a consistent result because of some other mechanism of actions of lenalidomide.
Celgene Patient Support provides patients with information about the insurance approval process and the financial help that may be available. Programs that may be available to help with the cost of your Celgene medicine differ by the type of insurance you have. Even if you don't have insurance or enough coverage to pay for your medicine, financial help may be available. Fast Track for first prescription may be available to help eligible patients receive their first prescription faster. You can call a Celgene patient support specialist at 1-800-931-8691.